Welcome everyone to the second talk of the day and our first keynote speaker on this third day of our summer school. It's my great pleasure to welcome Sepp Hochreiter, one of the pioneers of deep learning. So Sepp is now directing the LSU unit Linz and the Linz Institute of Technology, the AI lab there, the Institute for Machine Learning at the Johannes Kepler University Linz. So he has numerous important roles. He's also the founding director of the Institute of Advanced Research in Artificial Intelligence, IRAI. Sepp is known for this fundamental contribution to the field as an inventor of LSTM, of long short-term memory in 1997. And later on, he did a PhD at the Technical University of Munich, was a postdoc in Colorado, then a scientific assistant and working group leader at TU Berlin. And then in 2006, he moved to Linz, to the Johannes Kepler University, and became professor and head of Institute of Bioinformatics. So then he just mentioned that in the pre-talk. So then his focus was bioinformatics, and recently he has made a big comeback in AI, you can say. And he has received numerous honors for all his accomplishments. So in 2018, he was the Austrian of the Year in the category research, to name one of the highlights here. And this year, he received the IEEE CIS Neural Networks Pioneer Prize. This is a very fitting prize. I believe he's really one of the big pioneers in neural network research. We are very happy to have him here. I should not forget to mention that he's also in the board of directors of the ALICE initiative. You can see this in his virtual background already. So he's also shaping this European network of excellence in machine learning. Sepp, we are very happy that you are here, and we are excited now to follow your talk over the next hour. The floor is yours. Yeah.
Thanks, Carsten. Thank you for this kind introduction. I'm very honored to hear all of this. My LSTMs were already used in medicine, in bioinformatics. But today I want to introduce something else, which can also have multiple applications in medicine or bioinformatics. I will show you this. Carsten already mentioned it. It's my background also. Check out ALICE. Perhaps you can become an ALICE PhD student. Also, there's a big program there. It's a health program in ALICE. We also are applying for a molecule program where it's about drug design. ALICE, there's a lot of things going on. Carsten is in the center of everything. You can ask him how to become part of the society. You're invited. We need smart guys. We need innovative guys, motivated guys. Please join also the ALICE network, especially health molecules. Okay, today I'm going to talk about modern Hopfield networks. I have to put on his pictures away. Sorry for that. I want to introduce a new paradigm. And the new paradigm is to use associative memories in deep learning architectures. That's sort of new. It's already known partly from attention mechanisms from the transformer architecture. But what we have here we have a standard deep learning architecture. At the input, we have something, perhaps we have a matrix of different vectors. We push this matrix of vectors through a layer, have another matrix of vectors. Each vector is pushed through separately. And we do this, and at the end, we get a matrix of vectors, and we can then combine this matrix of vectors to a final output to make a prediction. Sometimes it's not a matrix, it's a single vector, but in general, you can push a whole set through a deep neural network. That's what's done right now, but I think that's not sufficient. That's functional approximation. We should go one step beyond that. And that's the idea here. Here I have a deep learning architecture, but in every layer, I have an associative memory. I equip every layer with an associative memory to give additional information, to enrich some processing by external information. And this external information can be everything. It could be information results, intermediate results from previous layers. We know this from attention mechanisms, but it could be also external information like names of diseases, gene expression profiles as references. It could be pathways information and stuff like this. And what we humans do, we humans are not function approximators. We humans always do processing with context. We always have associations, stuff reminds us to previous experiences and stuff like this. And I want to build such networks, networks which are enriched by some context, do processing with context, external context or internal context. Therefore, deep learning would go beyond convolutional or recurrent neural networks. We can include attention mechanism, memories. We can also process point sets, all this kind of stuff. The idea is integrate modern Hopfield networks into layers of deep learning architectures. And this gives us many new functionalities. We can do association of two sets. We can do pattern search in sets. We can do pooling operations. We can do memories. We can in the memory, we put a sequence, and then we can do stuff what LSTMs or gated recurrent units are doing. We can do something like vector quantization. Of course, we can do transformer attention, but that's well known, but it's only one aspect of this. We can do sequence-to-sequence learning. We can do all kind of point set operations. We can do multiple instance learning, and we even can implement at least some models of SVMs or k-nearest neighbor methods. And this for every layer. I want to introduce you to the modern Hopfield networks. Modern Hopfield networks were introduced by the seminal paper of Krotov and Hopfield, right? It's the original Hopfield, the Hopfield of 1982. He's now, I think, 87 years old, but still had a Neurips paper in 2016. Impressive. And this modern Hopfield networks were generalized by Demir Zigil in 2017. And the new stuff with these modern Hopfield networks is that they tremendously increase the storage capacity. So storage capacity is much, much larger. And a second property, which is important for us, is they converge extremely fast. In contrast, standard Hopfield networks, which are known from the old textbooks, associative memories and associative memories are known from the 60s and 70s. This is really old stuff. And so they were popularized by John Hopfield in 1982 and became famous under the name Hopfield networks. What's the standard Hopfield network? The standard Hopfield network, as introduced by John Hopfield in 1982. We have n patterns. These are binary patterns. I have to emphasize this is binary patterns, x1 to xn. And all the components of these patterns are either minus one or plus one. So they live in a d-dimensional space, but it's a binary, either minus one or plus one. And we construct, if we have patterns, we want to store the pattern towards this end. We want to construct a weight matrix where the patterns are stored. And the weight matrix is nothing else than the sum of outer products of these patterns, the patterns we want to store. And then after having constructed this weight matrix, we have a state or a query pattern. It's Xi. It's also binary. And it's also in the d-dimensional space. And we have an update rule. We start with a Xi. We multiply the Xi with this weight matrix W, which stores the patterns, subtract some constant vector, take the sign, and now we have plus one or minus one, and now multiplying by two and subtracting one transfers it to minus one or plus one. one of the two things. Set the update rule. We get the new Xi, it's a binary, from the old Xi. And if we do this iteratively, it's known for standard top field networks that we minimize an energy. It's energy, it's this binary energy, B is for binary energy. It's often written like this, but I write it like this because that's an interesting way to write it. It's successor state pattern, the query pattern here, times dot product, the pattern xi, and this dot product is just squared, and I go over all patterns. I have a state pattern, make a dot product with the stored pattern, square this dot product, and sum it up. Sets the energy. And here's some linear term, but the linear term is not the important part here. Sets standard top field networks. Property of standard top field networks, you store something like here's Homer, but Homer is stored, but now I only give in as a state pattern for this is Xi. For Xi, I only do half of Homer is masked out, and then I retrieve Homer again. But that's the best case, but normally things go bad for standard top field networks. I do this, but now I have stored three patterns, and now I get, first of all, it's complementary, and I get a different pattern out. It's complementary of this pattern. I don't get out Homer, and this is the problem because the patterns are highly correlated. It's the same here now, so it's marked two times in. I do half of Homer in, and I get out marked because it's a dominant pattern. It's much stronger stored in the weight matrix, and therefore I get out this. So energy minimization goes to this energy minimum because it's more dominant. And we get a lot of spurious minima if we store more patterns. Now again, the state pattern Xi, I give half of Homer to the network. And what I get out is a pattern like this. That's some kind of average of everything. If you look here, you see the same pattern here. It's some kind of average over all kind of patterns. It's not what we want to have. We want to have Homer, so full picture retrieved, but yeah, it's an average of everything. It's not what we want to have. And this is expressed also in the storage capacity. Hopfield used the diagonal matrix, set the diagonal matrix of the auto product to zero. You can do that, it doesn't change anything. And then with this kind of Hopfield networks, the storage capacity, meaning how many patterns can I store? That's the number of patterns I can store, storing and retrieving with, without interference. It's proportional to the dimension of the space. Here, without errors, you have to divide by log D. If you allow small retrieval errors, once in a while a retrieval error, since the storage capacity is 0.14 times the dimension of the space in which the patterns live, the binary patterns live. And now, 2016, with the seminal paper of Krutoff and Hopfield, the modern Hopfield networks were introduced. I show you the energy function. That's the energy function. Still, this modern Hopfield network of Krutoff and Hopfield are binary pattern, networks. But now we have the same, almost the same as the standard Hopfield networks. In the standard Hopfield networks, look at this. We have here the dot product squared. Here we have a dot product, but we apply a function capital F to the dot product. But what can capital F be? What Krutoff and Hopfield said, it can be any polynomial. It can be set to the power of A. For A equals 2, we recover the standard Hopfield network. But now we can do A equals 5 or A equals 10 or whatever and get a new energy function. And we can also do a minimization of the energy function. If we look at the component number J of this Xi of the actual state of the Hopfield network, we can check here the energy via Xi J is equals 1. I pulled out this component. And here Xi J is equal to minus 1. And now I check with energy, if I want to update only the J's component of Xi, is the energy with plus one or is the energy with minus one larger? I want to minimize energy, and now I choose of the two, the one which has lowest energy, and perhaps I have to switch Xi, or it remains the same. I do an update of Xi J of this one component. And doing this iteratively, always looking at another component randomly, this converges to an energy minimum that have been shown. And now it's also shown that the energy minima correspond to the stored pattern, but now the storage capacity, how many patterns can I store, is now polynomial in DD's dimension of the space. Still, we are in the binary cases, the binary networks. Without errors, now I have D to the power A minus 2. If A is equal to 2, that's the standard Hopfield network, it's D. We know this. But if is A is equal to 10, then it's D to the power of 9. And this could be a large number if the dimension of the pattern D is large. Still, there are some components here we have to divide by log D, but log D doesn't hurt us much. And if we allow small retrieval errors, we get some constant depending on A, but not depending on the dimension. And it's again polynomial in D. And that was a huge achievement of Krathoff and Hopfield to do this, because now many, many more patterns can be stored using this new energy function and also the update of the energy function. And this modern Hopfield networks of Krathoff and Hopfield were generalized by Demirci-Gil in 2017. And we again have this function f, but now for the function f, Demirci-Gil did not use a polynomial, but an exponential function. So it was stronger. And now we have the energy expressed by an exponential function. And it turns out that the storage capacity is really exponential in DD, the dimension of the space where the patterns live. The storage capacity is actually proportional to 2 to the power of D half. And there's another very important fact that convergence or retrieval of the pattern can be done with one update. This is a theorem from the paper of Demirci-Gil. If we have this x tilde, it's the same as xi in our case. Xi, if xi is close to a pattern, this is given by this radius and so on. If xi is close to a pattern, then the probability, no matter what patterns you look at, no matter what component of xi you want to update, if you do an update, here would be xi, of the chase component, set the chase component is not already the same component of the pattern which is stored, goes to zero. Meaning it's very likely that you do one update of one component, and it's the right one. It's very unlikely that you miss it. Therefore, if you touch every component once of this xi or here x tilde, then you already have retrieved the pattern. Therefore, it's super, super fast in convergence. You only have to touch each component once. Wow. Here we have what we know, our standard binary Hopfield network. We got this horrible retrieval. It's an average over everything. But if we do now the modern, still binary Hopfield network, we store the same pattern. We give in half of Homer. We perfectly can retrieve Homer. It's still binary. And even if you store many more patterns that are highly correlated, because the pixel are correlated, close by pixel have the same color. Here we give in half of Homer, and again we can retrieve Homer if there are many more images stored in this Hopfield network. But this is the capacity of this modern Hopfield networks. But now to our application, this modern Hopfield networks are binary. But I said I want to integrate them into deep learning architectures. But still, I want to learn these deep learning architectures by gradient descent, by backpropagation. What I need is I need some continuous version of this modern Hopfield network. The continuous version should be even differentiable to allow for gradient descent, for allow to back propagation. And what we want to keep still is retrieval with one update, because this means retrieval and update is the same. This means I can still do an activation of a layer. So activation of a layer versus activating the layer or retrieving a pattern from a memory, it's the same procedure. We don't see a difference. And I still want to have the higher storage capacity for complex tasks, perhaps in medicine, in bioinformatics, you want to store many data items you want to access. And therefore, the storage capacity should be very large. And to construct continuous Hopfield networks, we introduced a new energy function. Still, we have n patterns. These patterns are still d-dimensional, but now they are continuous patterns. They have real values. These are vectors with real values. And we construct a pattern matrix. We need m, where m is the length of the largest pattern. And we have a query pattern. It's also a real valued vector from a d-dimensional real valued vector. And we use, for the defining the energy function, the log sum exponential function. The log sum exponential function has this form. It's only the sum beta some parameter times the components, summed over all components log, and some normalizing constant beta to the minus one. That's the log sum exponential. And with the log sum exponential, we define a new energy function. And the energy function is here. Here you see the log sum exponential. This is minus LSE. Here in the state, we have a quadratic part in the state. And here is the only constant terms. We need these constant terms to make the energy larger than zero. It's easier for us to prove stuff and to bound it. Now we have this energy function. This energy function is now for real pattern, real valued patterns. It generalizes the energy function we know from binary pattern. This energy function is from Demirci-Gil. It's, we can rewrite it as the minus exponential of the LSE of this with beta equals one. Somehow this new energy function is similar to the energy function introduced by Demirci-Gil, but for continuous pattern, we need still this quadratic term. Otherwise, the state pattern would go to infinity, is not bounded. For binary, we don't have this problem because it's binary, the length is given. Here, the length is not given, and this can make problems. But this function works well as energy function, and we will show, we keep the properties like exponential storage capacity and even retrieval after one update. That's important features we want to keep. Coming to the update rule, we have a new update rule for the continuous modern Hopfield networks. The new Xi is the old Xi times the pattern matrix. This is all is the vector of dot products. Xi is multiplied by each pattern, and this dot products are put in the vector. And we do now a softmax of these vectors of dot products and multiply x with the softmax. Therefore, if perhaps Xi is very similar to one pattern, the softmax is like something 0, 0, and at some point is a 1, and you have many zeros, then you retract this pattern from here. If Xi is very similar, has a high dot product to a specific pattern, you would retrieve the corresponding pattern. But otherwise, you have a you have an average of patterns, and what you do, you minimize the energy with this update rule. And this is, I will skip this, it's going too far. We can prove with this update rule that the update converges normally to a local minima, in general to saddle points, but we only observed until now local minima. Maxima is very unlikely to observe, and as a stationary point, we never saw, normally it was always in a minimum. Then we also have to think about what does it mean for continuous values of storing and retrieving. For binary vectors, it's clear you want to have, if there's a one, you want to have a one and not a minus one. But for continuous vectors, what does it mean? If you're very, very close to the pattern, is it still retrieved? Yes, I would say yes. So if we define storing and retrieving like this, we assume that around each pattern which we want to store, xi, there's a sphere. And in the sphere, there's a fixed point of this update rule. And all points which are in the sphere converge to this fixed point. We have xi, so a pattern is in the sphere, so a fixed point is in the sphere, and all points converge to the fixed point, all even xi converges to this fixed point xi star. And important, the spheres don't have any point in common. They're separated. The intersection is the empty set. And now we say x is retrieved, so xi is a stored pattern is retrieved. If an iteration gives a point, this is called an iteration point xi tilde, which is at least epsilon close to the fixed point. So iteration would go to the fixed point, but we stop it already if we epsilon close. And then we have a retrieval error between this point where we stop the iteration and the stored pattern, that's a retrieval error. Meaning we have this sphere, in the sphere, we always converge to this fixed point. Each fixed point identifies one of the stored patterns. And we have a retrieval error where we stop the iterate, and the retrieval error is the difference, the norm to the stored pattern. And now, first of all, we can show it has exponential storage capacity. It's shown here. That's a property what we want to have, but I go over this. But also, as a second property, a retrieval with one update only. Also, this works. What does mean retrieval with one update? We have a query pattern xi, and f of xi, this is the update. And after one update step, the difference between the updated xi and the fixed point is smaller than epsilon. If it's smaller than epsilon, we say this has been retrieved. And we can show this is typically the case. The only thing what we have to assume is that the patterns are separated. What does mean separations? We have this delta I. Separation means that the dot product between a pattern with itself, or the length of the pattern squared, minus the dot product of the pattern with other pattern should be comparably large. Meaning if two patterns are very, very, very similar to each other, then if j equals three is very similar, then I get here a dot product, which is almost the same dot product as here. And then it's not well separated. Separation means xi multiplied by itself should be larger than xi multiplied by some xj, separation in terms of dot products. And now you see a retrieval after one update is possible if the separation is large enough. And we see this here, we do here some approximation with the Jacobian that's coming from the mean value theorem. And here we see that's here our separation. This separation is multiplied by the beta, and the separation is multiplied by the length of the vectors. Here we have a term, this is small, but this one is large. This terms are much smaller than this delta thing, because xi is close to x, otherwise I would not retrieve x. And the fixed point is also much closer to xi. And if this is sufficient large, then we have retrieval with one update. But we need a separation. At least if two patterns are very, very close to each other, we cannot pull them apart we will always retrieve both of them. And also with the same formula, you see the same formula times beta times m, sets the error, the retrieval error you do, and normally the retrieval error is also very, very small. But what happens if the patterns are not well separated? This might happen if some patterns, some vectors are very similar to one another. Some patterns are similar to one another, perhaps three or four patterns are similar to one another, but they're dissimilar to all other patterns. They're not similar to other patterns. So I mean, they're well separated to all others. There's a cluster of patterns that are similar to each other. Then we get the fixed point near the similar vectors. The fixed point is some average of the similar patterns. And this fixed point is a meter stable state of this energy function. And if the iterate starts near this fixed point or near these similar patterns, even if they start with the similar patterns, they go to this meter stable state, they converge to this fixed point. It would always give us an average over some patterns. What we already saw with the standard Hopfield networks, where we don't want to have it, but here we can do some kind of clustering, averaging of similar patterns. Here, this continuous neural Hopfield networks working. We stored many patterns. Here we see it's already gray value. We do half of Homer in and perfectly retrieve Homer, which we already know from the theory this should work even if the patterns are highly correlated. But if beta is too small, that's something like the inverse temperature, we get some kind of averaging of everything. We have to have high enough beta. The separation is always multiplied by beta. If the separation is small, you need higher beta to pull it apart again. Here we did it for different beta. You see first, it's an average, but if beta becomes larger and larger, the image of Homer becomes more and more visible, like the fog is lightning. You see now Homer better and better because the softmax pulling out this image becomes larger and larger. Here, another case, small beta, you get one fixed point only in the middle. It's the average of all the stored patterns. These black dots are the stored patterns. It's only two-dimensional. But as soon as you increase beta, you get a fixed point here, fixed point here. And for large enough beta, you get already four fixed points. It's a fixed point sitting almost on top of the stored patterns. And if you still increase it, you have four quadrants now, and also fixed points sitting on top of the stored patterns already. A very interesting fact is that our new update rule, that what we do for our continuous modern Hopfield networks, is the same as the transformer attention mechanisms. There's no difference at that. We have this new energy function, we have this update rule, and after doing like here some reformulation, because we do it in column writing and they do it in row writing, we get the transformer update rule. It's the same. Next question is, how can we integrate this new modern Hopfield networks into architectures? How do we do that? And there are more possibilities how to do it. First possibility would be the layer Hopfield. Here, R and Y comes from previous layer or directly from the input. R and Y are as a queries. This is a queries. Y as a stored patterns. Both queries and stored patterns. This is the queries and this is the stored patterns. Both queries and stored patterns come from the network, come from the input, might be intermediate results of the previous layer, or perhaps even results from the previous layer. If the results from the previous layer, it's transformer attention. But the idea is you propagate both the queries and the stored pattern through the network. But you can do different things, like with Hopfield pooling, you only propagate the Ys through the network. So Ys come from previous layer. What you store intermediate results or if it's an input from previous layer, but the queries are fixed, you always do the same queries, the queries are learned. What you can do, that would be like multiple instance learning, where the Y keeps the instances, or sequences, where always you always do the same sequence. In each layer, you present the original sequence, and now you probe with the queries, always the same sequence. That's learning a sequence, analyzing a sequence. What you also can do with the Hopfield layer, propagate R. R as a queries. What you store here is fixed. What you store is fixed. But what you propagate, you generate new queries. You always probe the same stored memory, but now with different queries. What you can do is here like something like SVMs or k-nearest neighbors, because here, if you store the training data, you can do here the training data, training data. You store the training data and you again and again probe the training data. You want to see what is closest to your current thing from the training data or what has the most similar values to the query you generated. Going through this layer, the first layer, this is this attention thing. You can do a transformer attention, you can do sequence to sequence learning, point set operation, because you compare actually two sets, and the two sets are computed in a previous layer. One set gives you the queries, the other set gives you what you store, your stored values. You can do all kind of retrieval based methods or decode, encode attention to something else. That's known from the attention mechanism. You can do more, you generate over sets and throw the two sets to each other. But here, that's a little bit different. Here, why? Is generated, and you always generate a new data set, you store it, and then you do fixed queries. You generate something, store all the data. Now at every layer, you do different queries. And then you generate a new Y at the higher layer, and you do the fixed queries. What you can do is you can do convolutions with this. You can do memories. If LSTM or GRUS to get you the current units are possible here, because you can always store the sequence here or some modified sequence, but always do fixed probing, like is there a certain pattern in the sequence? Is there a certain signal in the sequence? Here's a query, static, or even can be learned, can be adapted. It works for multiple instance learning, where you have the instances or a modification of the instances, you can do pattern search. Here, the last layer, it's where you generate the queries, but what you have in the memory is always fixed. You can do in the memory cluster centers, templates or references, k-nearest neighbor, similarity, learning vector quantization, or you do only discretization here. What we often do, we do training data or chemical reaction. We also do chemical reactions. Pathways, gene sets. These are all things we can put into it. Therefore, at every layer, the network has access to external knowledge, to knowledge what genes belong to which pathway exists, disease names we already did. This works good. The network don't have to learn it. It can memorize it because you explicitly provide it. Coming to the experiments, we did this deep learning architectures with modern Hopfield networks to many tasks, NLP, multiple instance learning, small classification tasks, drug design problems. I will go, we know already this and this because we said it's transformers, and that transformers or BERT models work well for natural language processing. That's known. Let's not do this. It's working well for multiple instance learning problem. I want to show you one specific multiple instance learning problem because it's in medicine or in bioinformatics. This is immune repertoire classification. Here's the idea is for multiple instance learning, you have few indicative patterns. of a large set of patterns, and you have to identify the indicative patterns. What is this about? You extract immune cells from the human body and do sequencing. And now the goal is you want to know, is this person immune against a certain disease? Like, is this person immune against COVID? You extract the immune cells, you sequence the immune cells because this is the only cells where DNA can be modified, and you look whether there's some pattern indicating immunity. But the problem is there are so many of the immune cells, it's a huge repertoire. You extract about 300,000 of the cells, you sequence 300,000 cells, and then you have the immune repertoire. Now I have 300,000 immune cells, and now I should figure out, hey, is this person immune against a certain disease? And this is one of the largest multiple instance learning tasks, because it's a multiple instance learning. Each cell is an instance, and you describe the patient or you describe the person by all the immune cells you have extracted and then sequenced. And most of the multiple instance learning methods fail because there are so many of these instances. Normally you have 100 instances, but here you have 300,000 instances. And with this modern Hopfish networks, this works. What we did is we used this Hopfish pooling stuff. We put all the instances after we the sequences, we embedded the sequences, push them through a neural network, and then have an embedding space. And in the embedding space, we store 300,000 patterns. And we learned fixed queries. The queries are specific for the disease. Now for this disease, we look, do I see this sequence? Do I see this sequence? Do I see this sequence? And here for real world data, this modern Hopfield networks work very well. So it gives the best performance, but also on real world data where the signals were implanted. We worked here with some guys from Oslo, the immune repertoire field, so looking at this. We also looked at LSTM generated data and other simulated data. Most important is real world, because you want to know whether it's working in the real world, and it's really working much better than the previous methods, even methods which were specifically designed for this task. And this idea is, hey, do all the cells in a memory learn probes to look for specific patterns, are they in the memory or not? If they're in the memory, I have this immune response. I know this person is immune against this disease. If it's not in, it's not. And it's not like it's a clear pattern. The pattern is not a fixed one. It's not a motif which is fixed. There are some variabilities, meaning you need something like similarities. You need these neural networks. It's not only a discrete search for given patterns. We did other multiple instance learning data sets, but I don't want to go into this. We did this for small, I also will skip this, small data sets. Here we will come out soon with a new method based on this. The idea here is for small data sets, we can keep the whole training set in the memory. And at every layer, we can probe against the training set. I have a new data item. Is this similar? Does it have this feature? Is this related to that? Therefore, we can learn somehow a learning algorithm where the training set is in every layer presented to the processing. And with the newest results that come out soon, we see we on small data sets constantly beat XGBoost and methods like this. That's not very common that you deep learning beats XGBoost on tabular data, on small data, but with this method it works because we give the training set again and again. That's on the small data sets, I think, but here we have something interesting also in terms of bioinformatics medicine. We did it on drug design data set. some main areas. One was antivirals, others was protein inhibitors, here specifically human beta secretors. Then we looked for a data set with metabolic effects. Here's a blood-brain barrier permeability, you know it from your brain, that's important. And very general side effects, if you do drug design, you want to see side effects. This is standard data sets known in drug design. We looked at them and we used Hopfield layer. We compared it to a support vector machine, to XGBoost, to random forest, and to deep neural networks, but also to graph neural networks, different graph neural networks, because this is very popular. And it turns out that in two of the four data set, we got the new state of the art with Hopfield networks. In the others, they do well, say competitive, but not the best ones. But that's impressive because they are very strong competitors. And here, by storing all the data, here you store all the subgraphs, you store all the side chains from the drug, and having access all the time to the original input really helps to get here new results. To summarize, we want to introduce a paradigm shift by integrating assistive memories into deep learning architecture. Paradigm shift in deep learning. Don't do deep learning, do deep learning by integrating context, by using some external knowledge. It could be a knowledge graph. It could be a database. It could be a web. It could be terminologies from medicine, from bioinformatics. You don't have to learn it. You can present all the stuff to the network directly, and you're much better and much faster, believe me. You can learn attention, memory, vector quantization, set association. In every layer, you can build something like an SVM model or a k-nearest neighbor, learning vector quantization. You can do in every layer pattern search, your search in a database you want to access. Or in every layer, you can present templates. We did this for templates of chemical reactions, and we get here in drug design for retro synthesis, figuring out how to build a molecule. We get the best results, unknown results, even in zero-shot learning, and the pharma companies are completely excited what's going on here. And here we did the chemical reactions, we put them in the memory and gave this network. And here some blog entries where you get the software, also the paper, and there's also a video by Yannick Kilcher. You can check out this. And so I will stop here, and thanks for your attention.
Sepp, thank you for this fascinating talk. It was really exciting, and it was actually easy to follow you because of the clarity in which you presented this, although it was very complicated material. Thank you very much for that. I'm sure there will be questions here. I see virtual applause coming in for you, and I also see raised hands. Yeah, Giovanni goes first.
Hi, so first of all, thank you. It's really an amazing talk. My question is on, I have a few, but I'll start with one. On the use of Hopfield layers for interpretability. So for biomedical applications, often it's very important to give a good explanation of the results of a machine learning model. Do you think these Hopfield layers could be used to try to provide these in some way? So for example, I could probe with different sets of patterns that I want to compare my hidden layers or my results to, so that I can give as an explanation the results close to, say, the closest co-expression network and the closest affected pathways. Do you think there's any possibilities for interpretability for these Hopfield layers, or it's something that's not really, let's say, feasible?
the answer is yes, I will go into this, elaborate on this answer. The second thing I have to say, we never thought about it, a good idea. I don't put it on my mind. Yes, because what you can do is if you provide something in your memory, you later can check what the network has used. Did it use this item or did it use this item? You can use something like pathways. Which pathways did it use? You use a knowledge graph. Which of the items of the knowledge graph did it use? And there you know at least the part it used to compile the final answer as the outcome, because the stuff which it had not accessed, it will not have used. This gives a little bit of interpretability. Another thing is because you are the boss of the external memory, you can put in here human concepts, because who tells you that the neural network will learn something like human concept, something you can understand? If you have something like speed, acceleration, survey, sets of concepts we know from mechanics, from physics, but a linear combination of these items work very well for a neural network. If you do a linear transformation of this, it's also something. Now you have a little bit of acceleration, a little bit of speed, and a little bit of the way you did. But now for humans, it's not clear anymore what this means. But for a neural network, it's the same. How can you guarantee that the neural network gives you something that you as a human can understand? But here with the modern Hopfield networks, you're under control. You only give concepts. You as a human have an idea about what it means. And so neural network can do everything with it. It can also do an average of concepts. Perhaps then you're lost. But if you clearly see so neural network accessed my concept number 17, then I say, hey, 17 was blah, blah. Now I have a connection to human understanding, to human concepts. And for normal neural networks, it's hard because do we understand what this neurons code for?
Mm-hmm. I understand. That sounds actually really exciting. Thank you.
Sure.
Thanks, both of you. Volker Tresp is the next in line.
Yes, hello. Hi, Volker.
Great talk, of course. Very exciting and very interesting to read up onto. So, in fact, my first, very first NIPS paper was a Hopfield type paper. And there we applied Hopfield networks to optimization problems. Uh-huh. And this was, I think, sort of dormant for many, many, many years. And now this is coming back in quantum computing because, for example, the D-Wave style of quantum computing is pretty similar to these old ideas of using Hopfield networks for optimization. Oh, yeah. So do you see an application of these modern Hopfield networks and optimization and maybe even a path to quantum computing?
Not very clear. I see some similarities like energy minimization or fast energy minimization. Also, Jan Liquin sometimes talks about energy-based models. There's a connection. Also, in quantum computing, I think there are different ways to do it. One is quantum annealing. And quantum annealing, if you have huge networks, you can perhaps use these techniques. To be honest, I'm not so deep in this topic. Perhaps I'm an amateur, I'm a dilettante in these topics. I see only on the surface, there could be a connection in terms of energy and energy minima and stuff like this. Also in terms of discretization, you go to an energy minimum. If you only go to the same energy minimum, it's the discretization kind of stuff. I see connections, but I don't have a clear picture. I hope there's something, but I'm not good enough in the other fields to really grab it.
Yeah, maybe these non-linearities are not really very easily be able to map, because I guess in some sense quantum computing is sort of linear. So maybe this non-linear stuff you need in the modern Hopfield networks might not easily be mapped to this type of quantum computing.
Yeah, then I would love it, because then you can build very big thing. You can put the whole knowledge graph, the whole Google knowledge into a memory and then access it somehow by associative associations. That would be great.
I mean, that's something very interesting because quantum computing is not really good on big data. No? So if you can sort of keep the big data somewhere else, no? Sort of in a hybrid solution, that could be attractive.
Yeah, yeah. But I'm not good in quantum computing. It's not my field. I perhaps say stupid things here, but it sounds very, very cool.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks to both of you. We also have a tool to allow for questions from the YouTube audience. I'll read out one question from there. So Christian Bock is asking, storing training data makes me think of overfitting. Can Hopfield layers learn patterns that do not exist in the data? For instance, a mean over observed patterns is the question.
That's an interesting thing. Yes and no, both is possible. First of all, we used it in a symbolic kind of thing with chemical reactions. A mean of chemical reactions is not a chemical reaction. So we connect symbolic to sub-symbolic computing because chemical reaction, applying a chemical reaction to a compound is completely symbolic. But in other cases, yes, you get these metastable states and you see, hey, there's an average, and the average makes much more sense. It comes up with something a new prototype, so to say, or a new cluster center automatically, and we observe this in some application, and then we say, hey, it makes absolutely sense that we use this as a prototype. Yes and no, depending on the application. Some applications we say you cannot average because it's symbolic. An average of symbolic things might not mean anything. In other cases, it makes perfectly sense, and cool new things come up.
Thank you. Thank you for that answer. I have a related question, which is you showed these applications with molecules and with graphs and graph convolutional networks. And you mentioned that you're looking at subgraphs there in different layers. I wondered if you look at a graph and all of its subgraphs, then I feel that this condition of separability that you described may be very often violated because a graph is very similar to its subgraphs. Yeah, so how do you deal with that? Is it just that your theoretical guarantees don't hold there, or but it still works in practice, or how do you deal with this phenomenon?
Actually, I don't deal with it. First of all, we have an embedding of the graphs into a subsymbolic thing and into vector space. But the nice thing is we can generalize our subgraphs. So we only look at the arithmetic ring, but not what specific molecules are on this. So you have a couple of subgraphs you store different subgraphs in your database, and now you make an average. But the average is only the backbone. Because all the other things are some nice modifications, but what's in common is some backbone structure. And therefore we have a metastable state which represents the backbone. And to put something on the backbone, you go to the specific patterns which are similar to each other, so similar to each other because they have the same backbone. Sometimes it helps, but I don't know whether it always helps because you get also similarities we don't want to have. But in this case, it sometimes helps because say you can generalize if you have different backbones and you have another thing which is a similar backbone because of this metastable state, a new structure you never saw is still similar because it is in the same realm of this metastable state of this fixed point because it's another similar patterns to the five patterns perhaps you already have or whatever.
Okay, very interesting, very interesting. Thank you for that. And Giovanni has another question, please, Giovanni.
Yes, thank you. I have a quick question. When you define how the patterns are stored and retrieved, you define the retrieval distance with the norm of the difference between the updated pattern, the updated query and the pattern. Is that the Euclidean norm? And is that an issue if your patterns are really high dimensional?
I define a norm on what?
When you define the
patterns. Okay, yeah. So patterns are stored. Yes, we used a Euclidean norm. Yeah, we have simplicity. If norms are, let's say, comparable to each other, they differ only by a certain number. But the Euclidean norm is the best one because also in the energy function we used sort of dot products. Dot products are very, as or let's say, so Euclidean norm can be derived from the dot product, is implied by the dot product. Therefore, we working with dot product. Also, this energy function has this psi transpose. Euclidean norm and dot products go very well hand in hand.
Mm-hmm.
Because Euclidean norm is an implied norm of this Hilbert space of this dot product. That's the feeling. We didn't use this fact, but for me, it's natural to use an Euclidean norm if you work with dot products, if you work in a Hilbert space.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, my question is basically, does it not become less informative if your patterns are like thousands dimensionals or tens of thousands
that's the interesting stuff, but we didn't exploit anything. What I want to go is, what we did right now is, we have now with this Hopfield network, better results on the CLIP model. The CLIP model is the stuff from OpenAI, where we have very high dimensional embedding vectors like 1024 or 2048. And it's still working. My dream would be I have embedding vectors. I have, because what I saw in the Hopfield network is not the original vector, but some thing which goes to the neural network, and then I have an embedding vector, a representation of the input. I want to store those. And what I would love to have is a sparse vector, a very high dimensional vector, but a sparse vector. If I have a sparse vector, the vectors are hopefully orthogonal to each other, because if you have a sparse vector, if only a few components are on and you multiply it with another sparse vector, it's very likely you get zero, because otherwise the components which are non-zero have to match. Therefore, you increase the orthogonality. And I think humans do things like this, that you have many concepts, but for in a specific situation, you only use few concepts. But we did do this sparseness, I could enforce, but sparseness would help to better retrieve. Sparseness would help to make the vectors I store in the Hopfield network more orthogonal to each other. It will help. And then I need a very high dimensional space to code my whole input into sparse components. So if I want to go into then 100,000 dimensional spaces with a few handful or hundreds of components switched on, that would be my dream. I'm not there. But yeah,
that's a good end to this public part of your presentation. Thank you so much, Sepp. That we were all fascinated. I can say sure. That for the whole network. And now it's time for this session with our doctoral students. They'll take you to a breakout room. The other PIs and I, we say goodbye here. Thank you again. Goodbye. I really enjoyed that. And now I wish you a good discussion round with our doctoral students in the network.